Obviously, we're doing this as part of the Prestige70 celebration. And I'm wondering, because you may have crossed paths. Did you ever cross paths with Bob Weinstock, the gentleman who founded Prestige?
I don't think I ever met Bob, no.
Yeah. You know, he had, you know, obviously, you know, a very, very unique approach, particularly early on in terms of putting musicians together. There was not a lot of rehearsal, and, you know, he put people in a room and let them do, you know, what great musicians do.
It's what a good producer does, is he finds the artists and puts them in the room and lets them do his thing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, one of the conversations I read that Miles had with him, when he brought Miles back to New York from East St. Louis, was the goal was to just find the best musicians he could and put Miles in the room with them and see what happened. And that's where you get these incredible, you know, half a dozen or whatever albums on Prestige with those remarkable names, Relaxin', Cookin', Steamin'.
Right.
It's an incredible body of work.
Right, right. Well, I mean, I don't have hard specific data on this, but knowing how those bands probably got put together, they weren't put together by a producer.
Mm.
That's for damn sure.
Mm.
Miles put those bands together. I don't think the producer had anything to do with choosing John Coltrane or Philly Joe Jones or, you know, that was completely Miles's. Miles's thing, but to give Miles the platform to make that music. By the way, those recordings, I don't know if you know this about Prestige, but the story that I got was all of those working, steaming, relaxing albums that were done as the completion of a contract.
Yes.
And they were done in just a few days.
Yes.
Right.
They were done like in two sessions, I believe, two or three.
Yeah,
like
that's right.
Yeah.
And because they were obviously, all of them were, I'm assuming, I'm pretty sure they were all first takes, pretty well first takes, because they, even time-wise, to get all of those tracks in, they would have to be throwing them down one after the other. But those were that was the set list that Miles was playing in clubs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, and that is absolutely the case.
Yeah.
You know, he had already signed to Columbia.
Right.
And he needed to complete his contract.
Right, right.
To Prestige. So last question. I mentioned in the open 22 Grammy Awards, nominated now for your 23rd. And we talked briefly about, you know, the Grammy Award being kind of an encouragement or motivation to do more. But as you look back at this kind of recognition, what does it mean to you?
It's just, I don't know how to say it. It's just I hope I'm not getting in the way of other people winning Grammys. you know, first of all, you know, in all deference to all of the very, very good works that the Grammy organization does in education and getting the laws to change in the favor of musicians and composers and artists and so forth. I'm with all of that. I'm definitely happy to be a member of NARIS for so long. But it must be said at one point that a competition is not part of the basic nature of an artist, and that's why you see this kind of response when you ask me or others, like, what does it mean to win Grammys? Because you're not out there to win something. You're out there to be with the other artists as this tacit, sometimes not so tacit, mission that we've got to just uplift spirits and just bring the music to the world. Mm. So everything that the Grammys do to accomplish that goal, and maybe a competition is the thing that makes people look into the show, you know, oh, who's gonna win, you know, like a football game.
Yeah.
But in actual fact, there's in my mind, art and music is such a subjective thing that all it can be is a popularity voting thing. So I thank all of those who vote, of course, because they're voting for me. Wow, mm-hmm. Gee, thanks. But I'm humbled by it. Yeah. But I just have to go out and write my next piece of music.
Mm-hmm. I lied. I have one additional question, because you mentioned uplifting spirits and your latest album, Antidote. That's very much the intention here.
Oh, without a doubt. We're the antidote. That's the whole idea of antidote. Mm. That's how the lyric came about. We dance and we sing and we play, and we don't particularly like war and cruelty. Mm. excuse me. That's what the artists are all about. So you could say in a humorous way that we're kind of an antidote. We come to town and boom. Have some of this. Go to another town. Look, take some of this. Get them dancing and singing, and get them on that wavelength. And because if you read the newspapers or the media, all you get is bad news. It's not true, by the way, that it's all bad news. But that's what you get inundated with. And there are, it's not a completely peaceful planet. so we're the antidote.
Yeah. Well. We very much enjoy the fact that you are the antidote in your music. We could not be more grateful that you took the time to join us. Chick Corea, thank you so much.
Well, thanks for your interest, man. I really enjoyed the conversation.
Great.
Okay. Awesome.